certain series. These are just becoming more and more popular, and we are really very, very fortunate today to have Dr. Wadley, an optometrist here in our community, as well as a very, very busy practice in Abilene as well. Has just been a lifesaver for our community. I remember the time when we did not have an optometrist here. And we appreciate Dr. Wadley and all that he does. We work very closely with him at the hospital. And so with that, I'm going to turn it over to him. He has a great presentation for us. Thank you.
Well, as Ted said, I'm Jimmy Wadley. I'm from Abilene, Texas. I'm an Abilene High School graduate. I actually had an uncle and aunt who lived out here for several years, named Don and Alva Jones. So far, they must have been really quiet because they've been gone for quite a while, passed away. That so far, I haven't found anybody out here who ever even knew them. So they must have been pretty quiet people. But I appreciate the way that we've been received in Eastland County over the last 3.5 years. We've enjoyed being here. And one thing that I noticed early on is it seems like macular degeneration, and I'm not going to throw a term out there and leave people wondering, you know, what in the world is that anyway, but we discovered that macular degeneration seems to be a huge problem out here, and it is becoming more and more of a huge problem all over the country, all over the nation. Macular degeneration in the United States, just like diabetes, is epidemic, and it's becoming more epidemic with people around my age. I'm 62 years old. It's becoming more epidemic in my age group, and I'm afraid it's going to become even more of a problem for that younger generation coming up. And we're going to talk a little bit about why we think that's happening, or rather, I think why we know that's happening. Before we get into that, I want y'all to understand just one short little thing, is that coming to my office is not necessarily a scary thing, and I'm really not speaking to the women when I say that. I'm speaking to the men, because when men reach their middle ages, they tend to start losing their near vision, and that the macho thing in them says, I'm not supposed to be losing that vision. And the women say, this is part of life, deal with it. We've had babies, move on. And so the men, unfortunately, us guys tend to be on the crybaby stage when we hit our mid-40s, early 50s. The women just kind of take it in stride. But I just wanted to show you that if you behave yourself, it's not necessarily a bad thing to show up at my office, but some things do happen in my office a little bit like this sometimes.
Mom, please, can we just leave?
You have to see the eye doctor, Eric.
But I hate the eye doctor. He always makes fun of me for being fat.
You're not fat. You're big bone.
That's what I told him, but he doesn't listen to reason.
Eric Cartman.
Hello, Eric.
Dr.
How's my little piggy today? I just say that because you're my little buddy.
Take it for an eye camera, all right? Keep
it back, don't kill yourself. Hop up on the chair. Don't break it now. Let's see how you guys are doing. All you have to do is read the letters. Can you see the letters?
Yes.
All right, read them out for me.
I am a little pig.
No, that was just a weird coincidence. I do not know how that happened. Wow, what are the odds of that? All right, let's get down to business, shall we?
Okay, that's a good idea. My mom's paying you to be a comedian.
Let's see, which is better, one or two? One or two?
They look exactly the same.
Just pick one. Or two?
I don't know, two.
Okay, one or two? One or two?
One.
One or two? One or two?
Two.
No, the answer is one, Piggy.
One! Ow, I hate you!
There's obviously a problem with your eyes. I'm going to have to dilate them and run some tests.
Okay, the best part of the presentation's over. So the most important thing there, let's bring your eye up, shall we? The most important thing there was the last slide. He had a choice between the cake and the apple. Everybody in here, for various reasons, know which is the better choice, right? So what we did, we just zoomed in on the inside of an eye. Did everybody see that kind of zoom in? You know, we're going through Stetson's eye. We're gonna right through, and this is what we see. Your brain, if you have one, is right back here. I really want y'all to know what a macula is. I have so many people that come into my office who have macular degeneration. They know that this is something that is damaging their vision, but they don't know exactly what the macula is. The word macula means spot. So we, you know, in the health professions, we don't really want to use normal language just because we have to impress people, you know. So we don't want to call this the retinal spot. We want to call it something fancy. So we call it the macula. The macula is a Latin word that means spot. So the central area of the retina, this little spot right here, is where your 20/20 image forms. Your focal rays, your light rays, will come to a focus right here and will generate an electrical charge that's carried by the optic nerve right here. We have nerve fibers that run over to, I'm sorry to put my fingers all over this, but we have nerve fibers that run from the macula over to the optic nerve. The optic nerve takes those electrical signals back to the brain. We form an image. If the macula is not functioning properly, well, then we're not going to get a proper signal back to the brain. Okay, so you can kind of pull out a little bit. So the macula is the central spot of the retina where our focal point is, our focus is supposed to take place. I already mentioned that it's epidemic in the United States. We can throw out all kinds of big numbers. There are some authorities that say that about 10 million people in the United States have macular degeneration. There are some authorities that say there are as many as 15 million that have macular degeneration. If you're sitting in a room with a few dozen people, a million is just a huge number that's really hard to really get a grip on. At least it is for me. So when I hear that 10 million people have macular degeneration, I'm just thinking, man, we got a ton of people with macular degeneration. But that doesn't tell me anything about what's happening in Eastland County. If we boil the numbers down, what that means to us in Eastland County is that somewhere between 500 and 600 people in this county have macular degeneration. There are two, and I'm going to talk about this a little bit more in a little bit. There are two major types of macular degeneration. We have dry degeneration and wet degeneration. I have people ask me all the time, which is the better one? Do I have the good one or the bad one? Well, they're both bad. So, Tondo, you have the bad one. There is no good one. Dry degeneration will damage your vision more slowly than wet degeneration will, but they will both tear your retinas up. So there's not a good one. That's all. All that is to say that, and when I said that we have about 500 people in Eastland County, that means that everybody in this room, if you have any kind of a social life at all, you know somebody that has macular degeneration. Does anybody in this room, you don't have to raise your hand, but just think about it, does anybody in this room not know somebody with macular degeneration? And if you think you don't, you probably do. You probably have a relative or a friend or neighbor who has macular degeneration, and they're dealing with it in some way, and they just haven't told you. But it's just getting to be more of a problem, and we want to deal with that. There is a little bit of a genetic predisposition to it. I've been asked before, who's at risk for macular degeneration? And I'm only gonna talk for about 15 more minutes, because I want to leave plenty of time for a conversation. I want y'all to ask me the things that are on your mind that maybe I can help with. There's a genetic predisposition to it, but all of us, all human beings, are at risk for macular degeneration. It's just that some humans are more at risk than others. because the things that can cause macular degeneration, we are all exposed to. The number one thing that we're exposed to as humans that can cause macular degeneration is sunlight. But we've got to have it. You know? So just like too much water can kill you, too much sunlight can destroy your too much of the different rays from the sun can destroy your retinas. So then the next thing that puts us at risk is nutrition. You know, most of my when I say nutrition, I'm adding in there anything that we put into our bodies, whether it be food, whether it be Candy's food, but tobacco, alcohol, things like that. People who smoke tend to have macular degeneration more than people who don't smoke. People who drink more heavily have more macular degeneration than people who don't drink heavily. So just like with almost anything else that damages our bodies, we come down to what is our lifestyle? What kind of lifestyle choices have we made as far as, you know, what we're putting in here? So,
you want to see what it looks like?
Yeah. Let's go to that.
You want to go to healthy eye and then?
Yeah. Let me show you a normal macula, and then we'll show you which you all have already seen. So here's our normal macula. This is actually the inside of Stetson's eye right here. And his macula is just absolutely the picture of what a macula should look like. This is absolutely just pristine and perfect. And then let's show you a little picture of what an eye with macular degeneration looks like. Yeah. Yeah. Even if you've never seen it before, it's pretty dramatic, isn't it? Can we get that arrow off of that?
I can't.
Okay, that's all right. We don't have
it. Was burned in.
Oh, it was
Caleb
burned in.
Couldn't scrub it out.
Okay, that's all right. Okay. So we have an optic nerve here. Here we have the macula. Oh, I wanted to tell you, the macula is only 2 millimeters in diameter. We're talking about a tiny little area that is so critical. You know, more of our brain, is there a neurologist in here? Good. I don't want anybody disagreeing with me if I've gotten this off, but I don't think I did. More of our brain is used for the function of vision than anything else that we do. You know, who's that guy that runs so fast in the Olympics that he said every
Bolt.
Bolt. Yeah, what a name.
Yeah, perfect.
Yeah. I mean, even his brain is used more for vision than for this, you know, Superman speed that he has. But all of that comes down to this critical little area inside our eye on our retina that's 2 millimeters in diameter. So, I mean, it's like, you know, that still, it blows me away when I think about that because it's so critical to what we do. All of this garbage here is just garbage. All these spots that have really messed up the macula. The macula is somewhere in here. And we've got a big hole in it right here. If you've ever heard the term drusen, if you go to your eye doctor and he says, well, overall, you're doing well, but I see a few little drusen. That's generally the first thing we see. Drusen are these big white spots here. Generally, the first thing we see in macular degeneration, whether you have the dry form or the wet form, we see the formation of drusen. What drusen are is it's piles of rubbish. It's dead retinal cells that haven't been cleaned out, and they're just piling up in just little clumps. Just like when you rake all your leaves, all your dead leaves out in the yard, and you rake them up into all these little piles. Well, somebody eventually is going to get rid of all that, but inside our eye, we have a problem with that. The big problem is everybody in here has heard about free radicals, right? Yeah, we talk about free radicals because we eat things and we drink things that have antioxidant properties so that we can control our free radicals. You know, free radicals are basically, boil it down very simply, and there are all kinds of big charts you can do. They're basically oxygen molecules that have gone crazy. When oxygen, you know, we have to have oxygen to breathe. As oxygen is used, it splits up. As it splits up, it wants to pair up again. And so, just as an example, I need two of something. Here we go. Okay. I'm going to take all this apart. I am an oxygen molecule, and I've got energy. I've got an electron here, and I've got an electron here. That represents energy. As I'm being used in the body, I start losing things. Like, I may lose one of my electrons. I'm now a free radical. I'm looking for a place to hook up so I can get myself. I'm going to steal your electron.
Okay.
She's a nice little molecule. So what I did, I'm a free radical, and I'm trying to steal your energy. And where I get it from is I get it from cells. And so the free radicals go in there, and they're looking for some more energy. They're looking for another electron, so they've got two of them. They always want to be in pairs. And so they're looking for one, and they see one in these retinal cells, or your heart cells, or your brain cells, or whatever, and they go and they try to steal one. And as they steal them, if that cell doesn't have any energy, I'll get it back. If it doesn't have any energy left, the cell's dying. So this is what free radicals, very simply put, that's what free radicals do to us. They go in, they're trying to destroy our cells. So to put it more simply, you've got a good guy and a bad guy. This is a good guy. And this is a little term, lutein. I'm gonna tell you what lutein is in a minute. For that, if you've never heard of lutein, you're now gonna hear of lutein. So we have a good guy called lutein, and then we have a bad guy. And he is a free radical. Mr. Lutein here is trying to save us from the free radical. Yeah, I said the free radical. The free radical. The free radical is trying to steal your energy. The antioxidant is the guy that comes in and tries to save you. He's trying to keep that free radical from taking your energy and killing your cells. And in our case, killing our retinal cells that happen to be in our macula, which is where our vision forms. Okay. So we get that. I really want y'all to have it ingrained about lutein, because lutein is what everybody in this room needs, by the way. Every single person in this room requires lutein in their diet, or we go blind. Okay, so.
All over there is dug in unthinkable.
Wait, you see him? You feel it?
He's jumped in the water.
Hey, right there. Look, there, right there.
To catch a wounded 650-pound gator.
Grab
the bravery of a battle-tested swamper.
Here he goes.
Jay Paul's holding a quarter ton of muscle and teeth in a headlock. The gator's still alive, only stunned. And at any moment,
go.
It could suddenly turn and stride. The boys are at an impasse when the 10-foot beast seems to recover. The gator is gaining strength with every passing step.
Y'all want to watch more of that? I love swamp people. So it says, Jay Paul wins. Jay Paul is the lutein. He wrestles that. He wins. He's in the water with a gator and he wins. But that's kind of what our antioxidants are up against. Free radicals are powerful little guys, and they're really in there trying to destroy us. I mentioned earlier sunlight. The simplest the simplest, most plentiful source of free radicals come from the sun. It's not like the sun is shooting out free radicals. What it does, that sunlight hits our retinas. We have oxygen molecules in our retinas. Certain wavelengths from the sun start splitting those oxygen molecules. And as those molecules split, well then they become free radicals. We've got to have things that help us fight against that. Lutein is a pigment. If you crack open an egg and that egg has a yolk, if it doesn't have a yolk, you need to be worried. But if that egg has a yolk, that yolk is almost always going to be yellow. If it ain't yellow, you know, throw it away, right? That yellow is yellow because of the pigments called lutein and zeaxanthin. So when we talk about, I don't want to get too detailed and crazy with terminology, but we talked about carotenoids in our food. Kind of where the idea of carrots being good for your vision, for your eyes came from. The carrots are full of carotenoids. Well, the most common and the most needed carotenoids for our eyes are lutein and zeaxanthin. Those things are found in almost anything we eat that has a yellow color to it or has a deep color to it. So I tell people in my office on a very frequent basis, you don't have to remember exactly every vegetable that I name. You don't have to remember every fruit that I name. Just remember that if you're eating a vegetable that has a deep color to it, it is almost always going to be a good source of lutein and zeaxanthin. Those pigments that are actually kind of built-in sunglasses for our retinas. So when the sunlight comes in, it hits the macula. But about the first thing it hits is that layer of lutein and zeaxanthin. As we eat this stuff in our diet, our body puts it in our eyes and it coats the macula. It also helps the retinal cells function. It protects them, also helps them function better. So when we're looking at people's eyes in the office, we're looking to see what does that macula look like in the way of color. We want to see if it has that nice, deep, rich, kind of a yellow, yellow-brown color to it. Kind of like y'all saw inside Stetson's eye here a little bit ago. Let's see, I was going to say something else there. Oh, so there's the role of sunglasses. Ultraviolet light is one of the wavelengths of light that damages our retinas. And so our sunglasses that have an ultraviolet block, that's what we're doing. We're trying to keep the sunlight from creating those free radicals inside our eye that compete for the energy of our retinal cells. Also to help prevent cataracts, by the way. So different things. Oh, yeah, number one, stop smoking. Don't ever start smoking. If you smoke, stop it while you can. I love having a platform where I can say that because I want to say it over and over and over. Because I really get tired of seeing macular degeneration. I don't want to see it anymore.
Yeah.
It's just devastating. And it's devastating for me to tell people that they have it. You know, it bothers me, it bothers them, and it's just not a good diagnosis whatsoever. It can't be cured. It can be controlled, hopefully, with nutrition and supplements. But anyway, so stop smoking. Eat the green leafy vegetables, darkly pigmented fruits. Goji berries are great. If you can get goji berries, you can get them at, I know you can get them at Drug Emporium in Abilene and the Whole Foods place in Abilene.
Yeah, and the Natural Grocers also.
Natural Grocers, that's what I was trying to think of. Yeah, that's where my wife gets them. They kind of have a funky taste to them. Callie back there at the back likes the taste of them. I can tolerate them. Blueberries are great. Strawberries are great. Oranges are great. Eggplant is great. If you can leave the skin on the eggplant, that's really the best part of the eggplant, that purple skin. Load it up with lutein and zeaxanthin. great sources. Egg yolks again, raw nuts. Raw nuts or just very lightly roasted. And we put whiskey on there just to get your attention. So no. That's to say, if you drink alcohol, just like everything else, you know, moderation. Moderation. Because when you drink alcohol, you're releasing a lot of free radicals in your system. And everybody in here knows what all those free radicals do to you. And you don't want to have to explain yourself the next morning.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we actually see people who have alcohol toxicity in their retinas, that their maculas are falling apart because of all the alcohol they drank back in college.
Wow.
And they may be my age. They may be 60 years old. But they were boozaholics in college, and now it's starting to catch up with them. So all this stuff is cumulative. Where are we at?
That's the last slide.
Oh, how about that?
Unless you want to go back to healthy, what healthy macula looks like, or you want me or Brandon, good eye or bad eye?
Yeah, I want to throw Brandon up there again.
Okay. He doesn't actually have it.
Yeah, he doesn't really have macular degeneration.
He just volunteered to have it.
He works with Stetson, and he's my next door neighbor, or he was until a couple of weeks ago. But he sold his house, and we're not sure what we're going to get next door because he has great kids, and I hated for him to move. But yeah, but remember, this is all just garbage. Okay, I want to shut up and let y'all ask questions. Yes,
cool.
What do you think about lutein supplements as opposed to natural lutein?
Thank you. Thank you, because I meant to say that. You want to get, and you don't have to remember this, but you can, exactly, you can look it up online, you can call my office, you have brochures here. There is a big study that's been ongoing for about 30 years now called the AREDS study, AREDS. The AREDS study has pinpointed, they were the ones that came up with the knowledge, not just the theory, but the knowledge that we have got to have a good supply of lutein and zeaxanthin in our diet. And so when you buy the supplements that have lutein and zeaxanthin in them, the ones you want are the ones that say that they are based on the AREDS formula, or that they have the AREDS formula, or they have the AREDS formula plus, that it's been boosted. Most of them, like Ocuvite and ICAPS, will have those. They will have they'll have 10 milligrams of lutein and 2 milligrams of zeaxanthin. The AREDS study has shown definitively over the years, and I'm one of those little science guys that says, I want to see the research. But they have shown definitively over the years that 10 milligrams of lutein, 2 milligrams of zeaxanthin are effective in controlling and managing macular degeneration. There are some that have as much as 20 milligrams of lutein and 4 milligrams of zeaxanthin. And then there are various others. Here's the good thing about it. You can't get toxic problems with lutein or zeaxanthin. Your body's going to use what it can manage to use, and it'll flush out all the rest of it. Won't damage your kidneys, won't damage your liver, won't damage anything. Too little of this stuff will hurt you. Too much of it, there's really no such thing. And I'm not avoiding your question, but back to it. As far as I've seen so far, getting lutein, the lutein and zeaxanthin that you find in the supplement, that stuff is derived from natural sources. And so getting it in your food or getting it in a pill doesn't seem to show any difference, which makes me kind of happy, because there are some people that can't tolerate certain foods, like people who are on blood thinners, like Coumadin. People on Coumadin are not supposed to eat certain green vegetables. You know, tear you up. And so getting the lutein and zeaxanthin in a capsule form or a pill form is a great thing for those folks. Did that answer?
Yes.
Okay.
I wanted to ask about the white spots.
Yeah.
Where the dead cells are. Are those bubbles, really?
No. I'm glad you asked that. No, they're really not bubbles. They are piles of stuff. They're just piles of junk. I should have brought an ultrasound scan of a macula. A normal macula has these nice, clean, smooth rows of retinal tissue. When you get these piles of rubbish, drusen, when you get drusen piled up in there, that retina looks like this on an ultrasound scan. Yeah. And the worse this is, generally the worse your vision is. One of the horrible, crummy things about macular degeneration is eyes with macular degeneration don't follow the rules of optics. And that's to say, in this eye, I have 6 units of nearsightedness. So I take a 6-unit lens and voila, I can see everybody who either loves me or hates me or just wants to get the heck out of here. So that's a great thing. But if I had macular degeneration, this eye might have 6 units of nearsightedness. This has 6 units of help, but I've also got all this. And so I put the lens on and say, okay, doc, I'm still not seeing good. I think I need a stronger lens. Well, you make it stronger all day long, but if your windshield's got mud all over it, it's still hard to see through that windshield. Wow. And that's the kind of thing that macular degeneration does to you. And so some people with macular degeneration will say, well, I can't see you. I'm so glad some men show up. But if, they'll say, yeah, I can't see that red bandana on your head unless I do this and kind of look out the side. Those people, you know, with macular degeneration, you have to find your spot when it gets bad. Yes, ma'am.
If you're diagnosed with macular degeneration and it's being treated by your doctor, mm-hmm. what are your chances of recovering from it? Because we have several people, members in our family, that are totally blind from this disease.
Yeah, that's the horrible thing. Any retinal cell that you lose, it's gone forever. They don't regenerate. The retina is actually an extension of your brain. The optic nerve is really not even a true nerve. It's a brain process. So you got your brain, and your brain has an extension made of all of these little nerve fibers, and then those nerve fibers enter the back of your eye and spread out. That's all one continuous thing with your brain. And most people know that when you have brain cells that die, they're gone. When you lose a chunk of your brain, it's gone. It doesn't regrow. Retinal cells don't regrow. They never regenerate. So anything you lose, it's gone. It's devastating. And that's a lot of why I say I hate to tell people they have macular degeneration. Because whatever they've lost, any cells that are dead, they're dead. Now, we know that nutritionally and supplementally, once we've got good nutrition, fighting all our little free radicals, and hopefully cleaning out, we can actually clean out some of these drusen. If we've got good retinal cells that are being blocked by the drusen, if we can clean some of those out, and now the light can hit the light receptor, that light receptor is going to work again. Yeah, if it's not dead. So it's not a very good answer to your question.
No, that helps.
It's one of those that just the minute somebody's diagnosed with macular degeneration, we really want them to start paying attention and fighting this. Yeah, change their diet, change their lifestyle, add those things that help, cut back on the things that get in the way. I have never told anybody, never eat another cookie. Well, I can't tell myself that. I don't do that. But we need to balance it. Yeah, that's the deal.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
What do you think about Theratears Nutrition?
I like it. It's good. Yeah.
How are they versus, I mean, if you take those, do you still need to take the Ocuvite?
I can't remember. I have patients who take Theratears Nutrition. I haven't had that in my office in a long time. I can't remember exactly what's in Theratears Nutrition. Do you know? You can help me.
Well, I know it's a lot of omega-3, but
yeah.
I don't know if it, I don't think it's got them in it.
Oh.
I may be wrong.
You're right. Thank you for reminding me. Yeah, Theratears, I'll get right to you. Theratears Nutrition is a great little thing because of the omega-3. We want the omega-3s. In fact, everybody, lutein and zeaxanthin are oil-soluble substances. So we need oils in our diet. You know, we don't ever want to completely cut fat and oils out of our diet. There's a place for butter and olive oil. Yeah, so we need that for lutein and zeaxanthin to be taken up in the body. We need those oils to help metabolize it. But then, so the Theratears Nutrition, that is more for people with dry eye problems. That's why Theratears came around in the first place, is to help us generate better, cleaner, and more quantity of tears. And so that omega-3 that's in there helps that. It's not going to compete with anything that has lutein and zeaxanthin in it. It's only going to complement it. In fact, I tell people very regularly, I've got several of my staff members here, and they've heard me say a million times, and they've said it a million times. They tell people, take your lutein and your zeaxanthin, you know, take your supplement that has that, and also take your supplement that has the omega-3s.
If you take one or two of the Theratears Nutrition,
yes.
Does that have enough of the good oil in it where you don't have to add other oils to it?
You know, I'm not really sure. I wish I had a better answer because, like I said, I haven't looked at the Theratears thing in a long time. I order omega-3s personally for myself from a company called PRN, and I order it online. The PRN has different formulations depending on what your personal situation is. Just like some people need more calcium in their diet, some people need a little more protein in their diet. Everybody's is more individualized, and so you have to kind of look at your own personal situation with that. Okay, I got myself on a tangent there. Let me make sure I answer your question.
Yes, you did. Now
Yes, those are the two brands that are more readily available than anything else. Those are the two major players in the macular degeneration supplement category. And so, I mean, you can find that stuff just about anywhere. There are other brands that are every bit as good. Those are just the ones that are easy to find.
Does that have omega-3 in them?
Doesn't.
No.
Doesn't have omega-3.
Is that Arids 2 have it?
Arids 2 basically has lutein, zeaxanthin, and zinc, and I think it's got another couple of things in it that that they think we need also. But the lutein and the zeaxanthin are the major things. So, but it doesn't have omega-3. To get your omega-3s, it has to be a separate thing. Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Mm-hmm. I'll get you in just a second.
Yeah, go ahead. The PRN, is that PRN.com? Is there a website for that?
Yeah, it's just like PRN.com.
Okay.
Or you could put in PRN Omega, something like that.
There's also saffron. They're doing a study on the second stage of a clinical trial on saffron. And it has the lutein and the zeaxanthin in it.
Mm-hmm.
And you can order those pills from this guy in California. I'm getting those, and they'll have like 20
mm-hmm.
milligrams of everything, 20 or something.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been hopeful on that.
Uh-huh.
The other thing is that I know from my condition is the thing that might help is they're doing stem cell research.
Mm-hmm.
And while they can't, you know, they think they might be able to regenerate some of the cells, you know, in your eye. So that's
mm-hmm.
coming, but it's not here.
Yeah, it's definitely a long way off,
yes.
Unfortunately. Yes, ma'am?
What do you know about retinitis pigmentosa?
Oh,
I
know too much about it, actually. It's like
is there anything she should be taking for sure?
She just needs a good diet. Really, she just needs a good diet, just as if she had macular degeneration. Just take the macular degeneration diet, protect whatever she can as long as she can, that retinitis pigmentosa is a runaway train. It's a horrible thing. Retinitis pigmentosa is a gradual degeneration of the retinal tissue that generally starts out at the side. It starts out in the peripheral retina, and it gradually just, I tell people, think of it as a big pile of glaciers that are coming at you from every direction. And those glaciers are destroying everything in their path. And sometimes the glaciers move a little more slowly, sometimes they move a little faster. We just, with our retinitis pigmentosa patients, we just pray that those glaciers move slowly because there's no stopping them. Mm. Nobody's found anything to stop them.
Wow.
Yeah. So I'm sorry to hear that. Oh, yes.
Could you talk about the UVA and UVB? I got a friend, she gets sunburned inside the car.
Yeah.
And I've heard that the front windshield will block it, but the side windshields don't.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know?
Lynn probably knows more about that than I do. Lynn's my optician. Well, our whole deal is, if it's ultraviolet, we want to block it. I'm not sure what the windshields are being done. I know that the windshields anymore do have UV blockers built into them. Everybody that drives a car that's younger than 15 years old, your windshield has a UV block built into it. So you're getting some UV block just from your windshield. The side windows, I think you're right. I'm not sure if any of them have. What do you think, Lynn?
The windshield, if it has it in there, it's written in that little print thing.
Oh, that print? Has it etched in there?
Say it in there.
Yeah. See, I told you, Lynn knows more about that than I do. Yeah. But you do. You want to block that. And really, regardless of what's going on with the windshields and windows, you want those shades on your face. There are certain wavelengths of blue that come through our windows and our windshields. Visible blue. Visible blue, if you're at risk, in other words, if you already have some drusen forming, if you ever have some other types of changes in your maculas that go along with macular degeneration, there are certain wavelengths of visible blue that create further damage. Hello, computer screens. Hello, cell phones.
Wow.
All that blue is coming off of.
Wow.
Keep those things away from your babies. If you have grandchildren and you have babies, give them, and yeah, they're all on these little things all the time. Limit their time. Casey? Yeah.
Her iPad.
Yeah. Oh yeah. But limit their time, because they've got all this stuff developing, and the more they're exposed to those blue rays that are coming off, the more damage that we're starting to see. Yes, ma'am.
What supplemental do you recommend for the lutein and the other?
Oh. Okay. Well, I like ICAPS. And I like
what is that?
ICAPS. It's just I-CAPS.
Okay.
Yeah, I like ICAPS. I like Occupy.
Spell that.
Ozuvite. There's
this.
You can get this stuff just about anywhere. Okay. There's also another one that I really, really like. Not just because it kind of packs a little more in there, but also the people who run this company are really, really nice people who are trying real hard to do a lot of research to help us. It's a company called Maxi Vision. And Maxi, M-A-X-I, and then Vision. And their stuff is starting, for the longest time, you could only get their stuff either online or calling their toll-free number, but they're starting to show up in drugstores. Yes, ma'am.
When you go in for your eye exam or routine eye exam, do most doctors automatically check for the macular degeneration, or do you have to ask for that to be done at your exam?
You should never have to ask for that. Mm-hmm. That should always be checked. But I will tell you this. Every profession has their members who do things a little too quickly and a little too carelessly. So that doesn't always happen. If you go in for your eye exam and you're dilated, thumbs up. If you go in for your eye exam and you're not dilated, you need to move on. because they're not looking at what they need to look at. And unfortunately, that happens, and I don't know why, and I apologize for it. So, but it doesn't happen in my office. Yes, sir?
I got diagnosed years ago with builder's eyes. I burned my eyes many times.
Builder's eyes?
Welder.
Oh, I thought you said builder's eyes. I'm crying. Man, I'm crying under the table because I don't know that one. I'm going to say, Mel, take it away.
Is that the same thing as that right there?
I don't think so. The thing is, we see all kinds of things with welders. I mean, you guys keep America rolling. I mean, all of our bridges would fall down without you guys, and we wouldn't have any water. But what y'all do to your eyes is pretty tough. I'm assuming you're a welder. Yeah. So, well, have you had burns before?
Oh yeah, if I had all the burn time, would burn my eyes.
Yeah. Yeah.
I wouldn't need to go work.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Did you use potato juice on them?
Oh yeah.
Yeah, it works. Potato juice is great for those flash burns or those arc burns. But I'm not sure what they, I really don't know. I mean, there's not really a chapter in our book called Welder's Eyes, but I'm assuming that whatever doctor said you have welder's eyes, maybe he was talking about you have scarring on your corneas. You know, the cornea is the front surface of the eye, and welders tend to have a lot of scars there because of all those arc burns, and that may be it. And you can end up with some permanent vision problems because of that. Yes, that's. I hope that's what they're calling it. But I don't think it would be macular degeneration. But you know, you are getting a whole lot of intense light that could do some damage to your maculas. So, good question. Yeah. Oh, right beside you.
If you give your body to science,
yes, ma'am.
The cornea has no blood running through it, so you can't get a disease.
Well,
and the cornea
it has
the only thing they can use.
That's right. Yeah, when you donate, you're right. When you donate your eyes to science, they use the cornea. Mm-hmm. And yeah, you don't have to worry about blood vessels. Yeah. Yes. Somebody?
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh,
okay.
The one in the gray.
Oh, yeah. Two questions.
Yes, ma'am.
You were saying about no smoking. What about secondhand smoke? Is that just as bad? And then I have another question.
And really, that's secondhand smoke. That's kind of up in the air. I didn't really mean to make fun out of that, but it really is kind of up in the air. There are some studies that say yes. There are some that say no. Other than it just being annoying, yeah. But my go-to is avoid it. Yeah. So, and then another.
And then, if you've never had been diagnosed with it, what is something that we can watch for before going in?
Oh, gotcha.
That kind of alerts.
Yeah, really, about the only thing that you'll notice with macular degeneration is just the world's getting fuzzy, and it. Most people who come in with macular degeneration early on, they think they just need a change in their glasses prescription. And this is why I'm glad you said that, because it lets me get on a quick little tangent about online eye exams. I actually had a local nurse come into the office about a month ago. She didn't need me to do anything except refit her contact lenses because she had her paper with her. She had done an online eye exam.
See, I didn't know you could do that.
It's not legal in Texas.
Oh.
And in most states, but you know, a lot of those online companies don't care what's legal and what's not.
Wow.
But they think that takes the place of it because they actually have a doctor somewhere who really needs to have his license revoked. And let's all get a chance to beat him up a little bit first. Who they have some kind of stuff that shows up on your computer that helps you quote check your own eyes. And it generates a glasses prescription for you. So she brought that in. Well, there is something you can't do online. You can't see if you've got cataracts, and you definitely can't see if you have diabetic retinopathy, which is just as bad in this country as macular degeneration is. That's a topic for a different day. But and you can't check for macular degeneration that way. And their thing is, well, if online, in your online exam, if we can correct your vision better than 2040 or better, well, then you're good to go. You don't really need a doctor. So I saw a guy, and so to further illustrate that, I saw a guy in the office a couple of weeks ago. He's being seen by the retinal specialist this morning. But so I saw this guy in the office a couple of weeks ago. He just thought he needed stronger glasses. We couldn't quite correct him as good as we wanted to, but we could get him to 20/40. He had blood in his retina from diabetes. Or no, his was hypertension, wasn't it? Yeah, his was from hypertension. He had blood in his retina. And so you can't get that online, so I'm not sure if I answered the question. But
what about cataracts?
Uh-huh.
You know,
I have one.
You have one? Do you know who does good surgery for cataracts?
I do.
Yeah. You do.
If you, if you ask me after this, I will tell you. But I will tell you that I don't know of a bad cataract surgeon in this area.
Oh, well,
I know a whole bunch of really good ones.
So the Medicare usually cover cataract surgery.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah, Medicare will cover your cataract surgery. Right, Mel?
80-20.
80-20, thank you. 80-20. They'll pay 80%, and then you get 20% or your supplement. Yeah.
So
this is the lady to ask the insurance question.
James, are we doing cataract surgery here?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I just happened to.
Let me back up a little bit. I recommend cataract surgery at this
Thank you, Dr. Wall.
And I want my check.
We have three ophthalmologists that come here.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
And I do recommend all three of them.
Do you both generally do both eyes at the same time or one at a time?
They usually do one at a time. They'll do one, let it heal the way it's supposed to, make sure that they don't run into complications, because everybody can react differently to a surgery. Even if the surgery goes very beautifully, you still might not heal and react the way you're supposed to. So they don't want to endanger both eyes.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you, cataract surgery, I tell people every day, I've already told a couple of people in my office this morning, if you have any kind of eye problem whatsoever, the one, as you get, you know, that are aging related, the one we want you to have is cataracts. That's the easiest thing in the world to fix. So there was somebody else. Hang on,
yes.
I was thinking there was somebody over here. Am I crazy? Okay. Yes, ma'am.
I had cataract surgery.
Yes, you did.
Rocky McAdams, and he was wonderful. And he did one, and then he did the other. But now, it's my eyes get, they feel like they're real dry.
Mm-hmm.
And so I called his office, and the girl said that Systane was a good eye drop thing. Is that going to just last forever? And why is it that my eyes are dry after a cataract surgery?
We don't know. yeah.
Thank
and,
you.
And here's we really don't know, because everybody reacts differently. After you've had surgery, your body always wants to go through an inflammatory process. So they put you on steroid drops after the surgery to stop that inflammatory process or to prevent it. You still might have a little bit. And even if you had just a little bit of an inflammatory process, that can create a chronic dry eye syndrome that may clear up over the next few months. It may continue to plague you a little bit. Systane Ultra is our number one go-to.
Okay.
So, good question. But it varies from individual to individual. But I'll tell you, the highest risk demographic for chronic dry eye syndrome, middle age, Caucasian, women who live in dry, sunny, warm climates.
I know somebody like that.
Yeah. Yeah, here we are.
What is a wrinkle retina compared to macular degeneration?
Very, very different. Very, very different. A wrinkled retina is usually caused by something we call an epiretinal membrane. You don't have to worry about that. But it's generally due to a little traumatic event that can happen, like a set up a little concussion wave in your eye. So if you hit your head, yeah, the eye is a fluid system. If you hit your head, it's going to set up a little shock wave in your eye, and that shock wave may or may not do anything. There are other things that cause a wrinkled retina, but that's just one of them. And if the retina gets a little upset and it kind of wrinkles a little bit, kind of ripples a little bit, that can definitely hurt your vision. A lot of times that will, over time, kind of heal up a little bit. Sometimes a retinal specialist can go in and smooth things out. I'm over simplifying a little bit, but basically it's not a degenerative process like macular degeneration. You've still got healthy retinal cells there.
Can you get
your
second vision?
Sure. A lot of people get second sight. A lot of people get what's called second sight. And, generally what second sight is, if you are moderately nearsighted, the natural aging process, so you're nearsighted here, you're perfect here, you're farsighted here. The natural aging process pushes you towards farsightedness. So if you're a little bit nearsighted and you're kind of just sliding this way, at some point you hit, if you're lucky, you hit where everything's just right. And then it may keep going this way. But that's generally what happens in the little thing that's called second sight. And so, yes?
I can tell in eye drops to use preservative-free eye drops.
Yeah.
And of course, on the preservative-free, it says not to, you know, once you open it up to use it.
Yeah.
But I usually let it last. I mean, it usually lasts for me 2 to 3 days. Is that okay with not having preservatives in it?
It depends on what the particular drop is, but if you keep it in the refrigerator, it's going to keep better. Okay. Most likely you're going to be okay, especially if you don't touch the dropper tip to your eyes. Some people have to use preservative-free. Most of the preservatives that are in eye drops anymore don't do any kind of damage to the corneal surface. Some people, though, just like we were saying, you know, everybody's different. Some people's corneas don't mix well with those preservatives, and so they have to use preservative-free. So, yeah. So, but if you keep, but yeah, generally 2 or 3 days. If you keep it in the fridge, it's okay. Yeah,
that's. If you keep it 2 or 3 days, you just about have to put it in the refrigerator instead of just.
Yeah, yeah. If you leave it sitting out, nice and warm, yeah, you can grow all kinds of fun stuff in there. Yeah, yeah. And if you want to grow fun stuff. Yeah, I need to shut up, don't I? We have to start seeing patients at the office at 1:30.
Okay.
If anybody else has any questions, I'll stick around for about 5 or 10 more minutes. Yeah, and they'll all leave me, and then they'll be calling me and saying, "We have a patient ready."
Y'all, this has been excellent. Thank you, doctor.